Pingyao is a well-preserved ancient town of the Ming and Qing dynasties. It is also one of the best-known scenic spots in Shanxi province. This small shop looks no different from other shops. Yet an invaluable asset is concealed deep in this small courtyard, an inscribed board that reads, Land of Exchange. This is not an ordinary board. It's believed to be a reward given to the owner of this courtyard by Emperor Dao Guang in the 1830s. The inscribed characters were handwritten by the emperor. Why did the emperor care about a courtyard owner in a small town? How did the inconspicuous shop relate to the land of exchange? What kind of legend is hidden within this small courtyard? These are the Taihong Mountains, located between the Shanxi Plateau and the North China Plain. Before the 20th century, it was a traffic hub for traveling Shanxi merchants. In 1823, a team of armed escorts was heading to the capital. The cases under protection contained a payment prepared by Xi Yu Chang Pigment Shop, the largest pigment shop in Shanxi. The hurrying escorts had no idea that the dense wood was shrouded in the shadow of death. Like many passing merchants and tourists, the escorts didn't escape the misfortune. There was fighting, and the huge sum of money was carried off by bandits. On discovering that his money had been robbed, Li Dachuan, the owner of the pigment shop, suddenly lost interest in watching the play. The shop was very influential in Shanxi's pigment industry. Its business covered the whole of China. The amount of money lost every year during the delivery process was astonishing. After careful thinking and seeing that his boss was so anxious, the shopkeeper proposed a bold plan. He told Li that if the plan went well as he expected, the misfortune that had befallen the shop might be overcome. The shopkeeper was called Lei Lu Tai. He worked in Xi Yu Cheng's Beijing branch. Lei was born into a merchant family in Pingyao. When he was young, his family fell on hard times, and he worked in various shops as an apprentice. Then he joined Xi Yu Cheng and was appreciated by Li, who appointed him as the shopkeeper of the Beijing branch. He knew that these robberies were no accident. Other shops also suffered frequent robberies. Before the 19th century, similar tragedies were repeated time and time again in China. the bandits' only target, with silver being delivered across vast distances. In 1574, two ships loaded with silk, cotton cloth, and porcelain wares set off from the port of Xiamen, heading to Acapulco, Mexico. This marked the start of a new marine trading route. As exquisite Chinese artworks were delivered, a huge amount of silver from Spain's American colonies flowed steadily into China. Many Spanish colonists complained that the Chinese merchants had carried away almost all the silver from New Spain.
中国基本属于产品输出的一方，西方人大量需要中国的产品，而中国呢，并不需要它的产品，原因基本是两个，一个是5000年的文明导致我们的产品更雾霾，人多更价廉，另一方面呢，当时的中国是总的国民生产总值超过西方。 但人均国民生产总值不如人家，我们的购买力上不去，进而就导致东西方的贸易当中，西方大量的货币到了中国。In
1631 alone, about 1.4 million taels of silver entered Macau from abroad. It was almost four times the national income of the treasury. By about the middle of the 17th century, copper coins, silk, and grain were gradually replaced by silver as the most widely used currency in China. However, the inflow of silver was accompanied by trouble. The standard weight of a shoe-shaped silver ingot like this was 50 taels. They were mostly cast by official institutions and were inscribed with the name of the workers who cast them, as well as the casting institution itself.
Your 银两啊，由于成色不一样，形制不一样，重量差异也很大，所以在一个地区流通必须经过当地银炉重新铸造，这样的话才有一个统一的标准。那么这个过程中呢，也增加了白银在流通中的一定的成本。
Apart from the consumption of manpower and materials for the recasting of silver ingots, the exchange process for silver and copper coins was another problem. Traditional coins were still in circulation, and every emperor ordered the casting of coins with their own reign titles.
比较长的时间内是1两白银可以兑1千个纸钱，一个纸钱的表装重量是1千二分，那么这1千枚铜钱的重量呢就是7斤半。如果拿一个银元宝50两白银，可能就要有188公斤的这么多铜钱，所以呢，这个兑换呀还是非常必要的。
因为磅重的铜钱搬运在流通中是很不方便。
Another problem was the security of silver during transportation. This is the former site of the Tongxing Gong Escort Agency in Pingyao. Since Shanxi merchants traveling long distances to do business during the Ming and Qing dynasties often carried a large amount of silver with them, escort agencies became very popular. Tongxing Gong was the largest one.Yet even with armed escorts, money was often robbed by bandits during transportation. The merchants were in dire need of a safe method of transportation. To come up with a solution required extraordinary wisdom. As a Shi Yu Cheng shopkeeper, Lei was more than aware of the inconvenience and dangers involved in silver transportation. Yet as a shrewd merchant, he also saw a business opportunity.
This 当中有一个偶然性的事件，就是他在北京做经理，啊，那么山西人在北京经商的人。过去经商跟现在不一样，交通不方便，他几年回不了家，他有挂记家庭的人需要往家捎钱，但往家捎钱嘛，当找个合适的人能捎回去啊，这个合适的人不好找，另外这次给他钱，钱也很重，路上也不安全啊，在这种情况下人们就找到他啊，他是大公司啊，那么别人找他来带钱总不能白带吧，人情也当给人家点服务费吧，对图也没有个价格，你觉得多小是多小啊，那么到年底一算啊，这个额外的挣了钱比那个主业挣的还多，这下子就感到哦，这是个机会，社会有这种强烈的需要。
An idea gradually formed in Lei's mind. He tried to convince his boss to start a new kind of business that specialized in silver exchange. Lei described the procedure to his boss, Li Dachuan. First, the shop at place A would receive money from the remitter and give. This is the earliest paper currency in the world, created 1,000 years ago.
北宋打下这个蜀国啊，这个以后呢，他对那个四川那个有一种在货币方面有一种歧视的规定，啊，不许他们用铜钱，用铁钱。 所以呢，四川的商人啊，当时这个就是救蜀国的商人，他们用这个铁钱感到很不方便，哎，这个或很重，携带那个交易都不方便，所以有什么十几家，那个资本比较雄厚、商誉比较好的商号，就联合起来，决定啊用比较轻、纸印制比较方便的这个纸来做货币。哎，所以当时他们就把称之为交子。
The circulation area and the value of the money were written on the note, which made it very easy to use. The issue of the note was even controlled by the government at one point. However, since it could easily cause inflation, the issuance of the note was finally abolished.In the Yuan and Ming dynasties, paper currency was also used, but was eventually abolished too. After the Ming dynasty, to make things easier for their clients, some money shops and loan shops specializing in financial services had also issued large denomination paper money, but it was not circulated in very large areas.
钱庄呢，主要就是从事这个银和钱的兑换，资本比较小，它不没有说在外面其他地方开设分号的啊，钱庄没有，发展的不那么快，所以他们没有发展出这个异地汇兑，账局呢也主要就是放款，哎，他也不没有去从事这个异地汇兑的这种业务。
These money shops and loan agencies usually had no branches. When their clients traveled to other places, they could not exchange their paper money, meaning that their paper money often became waste paper. Such problems greatly troubled the merchants.Lei realized that if the shop in his imagination could solve the problems of remote remittance, it would be very popular indeed. Yet Lei's boss had his own worries. In his mind, the financial institution in Lei's assumption must have a perfect credit system.Strong risk defense capability and a sustainable profit model. With meticulous planning, Li reconstructed his pigment shop in Pingyao's most bustling street into a private bank, specializing in remote remittance.He named it Rishen Chan, meaning the rising sun. Lei became the first Rishen Chan shopkeeper. The year was 1823. What did Lei do to dispel his boss's worries?Could Ersheng Chang survive in a town full of commercial tenants? When a client's silver was checked at the counter of Ersheng Chang, the client would get a small receipt, the draft.This is a Rishen Chang draft kept in the Shanxi Businessman Museum. It was issued in Biancheng. The remitter was a man called Xu. It states on the draft that Xu remitted 500 taels of silver to Beijing. The Beijing branch should return the exact amount of silver to him on seeing the draft. It was a regulation of Ersheng Chang that whoever had the draft could exchange it for silver immediately at Ersheng Chang branch. But wasn't Lei worried about forged drafts? In fact, during more than 100 years of operation, Ersheng Chang never suffered any losses due to forged drafts. How did Lei achieve this? When Ersheng Chang was first built, all the drafts were handwritten by Lei himself. To preclude forged drafts, he required that all the shopkeepers of Ersheng Chang's branches must be familiar with his handwriting.
笔法呀，点如桃，撇如刀啊，这个什么，他。
时间，如果到了个七八成的时间啊，然后再拿上特制的那个滚筒，这一滚，那上面就有了什么了？比如说你是哪个票号，就有了票号的标志啊。那么表面上看不出来，但是他拿的特制的工具啊，他一看他就能看出来。
But even with the handwriting forgery prevention method.And the special paper, Lei was still worried. He was worried that if someone who could forge his handwriting stole some of the draft paper, what could he do? For the entire winter, Lei thought about the problem. Watching the peach flowers in full blossom in the spring,Lei recalled a poem written by famous Chinese poet Du Fu. Though a country be sundered, hills and rivers endure, and spring comes green again to trees and grasses, where petals have been shed like tears, and lonely birds have sung their grief. Suddenly, he got inspiration.Lei brought to mind a story in which a military strategist called Zheng Gongliang used this poem as a code book during battles. The first word of each line represented soldiers, generals, army provisions, and weapons. If a troop fell short of soldiers, they would write the code word for soldiers and then stamp a seal on the document. In this way, The one receiving the document would be clear of the troops' needs. Even if the document fell into enemy hands, they would not know what it meant. This is a code book used at the time. The numbers 1 to 9 are written in 2 lines on the right, and the code word corresponding to each number appears underneath. Lei borrowed ideas from the military thinker Zheng and created his own code word system.
He used 12 words to represent 再用30个汉字，方便代表初一到三十。这样的话，他随便写2个字儿，就能够代表了他的时间，外人看不懂。另外是对于银两数字，他也有一个规定：1、2、3、4、5、6、7、8、9、10，10个字，方便用10个汉字来代表。哪一个汉字代表一个什么含义，它不是固定不变的，过一段时期就换了。换了相关人员死记硬背，烂在脑子里，谁都不知道，来保证他的这个票据的安全。
On this particular draft, there is a line of words to the left of the remitter's name and the amount of money. These words were the code words. Except for the shopkeeper, no one knew what the words meant.The safety measures of special handwriting, special paper, and the code words made it very difficult to forge a draft. Today, in the exhibition hall of Ershangchang's former site, tourists can see the code word song hung on the wall.In Lei's time, the song was passed around only inside the bank. Apart from that, Lei also realized the importance of the staff's honesty and integrity in a private bank that dealt with money every day. This is a recommendation letter that has been preserved.The person recommended did not apply for a crucial post. He only wanted to be an apprentice. But it turned out that those who wanted to work in a private bank had to find a local guarantor who enjoyed a good reputation. The staff selection was very strict. Apart from the recommendation requirement, there were also many other regulations that sound unbelievable today.
票号用人制度特别强调的是用香不用亲，这由宝剑破开提拔。所谓用香不用亲呢，就是说原则上只用本地人，因为本地人呢知根知底，落叶要归根，不至于呢受骗上当。不用亲指的是自己的子女一般不在自己的商号工作，特别是不用姑爷、舅爷、少爷，这样的话能保证票号里制度的严格执行。
Those who passed the selection process had to go through a 3-year apprentice period. During this time, they would not get paid.Or be permitted to go home.
3年期间呢，所有的这学徒站立服务，不设座位。提三壶，高位上，列苦工。 白天站立服务，晚上呢练习写字，练习打算盘，背诵这个银两折合口诀，银两的橙色的折合口诀和铁平的折合口诀，这都是他们的基本功，这是业务训练。在蒙古地区、新疆和国外的纺织机构，他们还要学习外语。
During the 3 years, the shopkeeper observed not only the apprentice's training, but more importantly, their moral standing.
有事啊，这个故意的在地上丢一些钱，啊，那么然后偷偷的看学徒的表现，有的学徒拿了起来交给领导，这个学徒经受住了财富的诱惑。有的呢，拿了以后要做一些思想斗争，过两天再交去。他说这个人入则还可教。有的呢，拿了放在口袋里，再也不交了。这种人受不住诱惑，受不住诱惑，不是说不能改造，但是改造的比较难吧，东家就打发回家。
Having completed the apprenticeship period, the young men would immediately be assigned to various branches to accumulate real work experience.
在那学徒期满就可以成为正式员工，正式员工就有工资，而且有津贴，干得好还可以顶神谷，干得再好还可以提拔起来当部门经理，一直当大掌柜，就给他一种归属感和奋斗目标，所以他这一套缺拔人非常之讲究。
These interlacing measures finally dispelled Lee's worriesand became the regulations of the entire industry in later days. The silver that had been deposited was put into Rersheng.
借一些钱，那个作为那个调剂啊资金。
一方面包含钱庄，一方面包含银行，一方面还包含其他需要的人，无论谁需要都有个利息。
Ersheng Chang lent the silver during the free period to any institution or individual in need at a relatively low interest rate. With the remittance fees and the loaned interest, Ersheng Chang was making more and more money. However, Ersheng Chang's earnings were more than remittance fees and loan interest. At the time, the scales used to weigh silver at different places were different. There were over 1,000 kinds of weights used with different scales. The private banks had branches all over China. Without a uniform standard, it was very difficult to do accurate accounting.Therefore, they established their own scale standard. All the branches had to use the standard scale to weigh the received silver. This created extra profit for them.
Pian Hao, 在办理汇兑业务中，白银从接地收进。在一地付出，在一收一付之中，由于贴平砝码的差异，会产生一种余平，就是平色余利，结成余平。从我们看的史料，现有史料看呢，最少时候，一个方号一年有几平。
To fame during the Ming Dynasty, when many people from Shanxi walked through the pass to the Mongolian prairie to seek a better life. The northern areas of Shanxi.Are located on the lowest plateau. The land was barren and frequently stricken by natural disasters. Struggling with the poor living environment, local people set their eyes on the land outside the pass. During the mid-Ming Dynasty, the political situation was relatively steady. Many merchants from Shanxi province started to do business outside the pass. This is an old photo left by a Shanxi merchant. They usually set off in February or March each year, carrying with them bricks of tea, tobacco, liquor, matches, and food. Craftsmen would also carry their tools with them. In this way, they accumulated wealth little by little.
山西商人在外地经商的人到底有多少，没有一个精确的统计。但是据1933年7月1号山海关的统计，东北沦陷以后，由东北返回来的山西商人有17万人，但是呢，仅占在东北的山西商人的1/3。
During the Qing Dynasty, the footprints of Shanxi merchants even reached as far as the heartland of Eurasia. Shanxi merchants dominated the trade, processing and transportation of tea, grain, fur, silk and cotton between these areas in China. Many venerable shops and brands emerged at that time.This inconspicuous courtyard is in Hohhot, in the Inner Mongolia Autonomous Region. Few people know that 300 years ago, it used to be the site of a famous shop called Da Sheng Kui. In the 17th century, Da Sheng Kui operated all the trading routes between Uliastai.Russia, and inland China. Their footprints cover the Mongolian prairie, Central Asia, and Russia, and the shop had over 10,000 employees at its peak. These articles are left over from those days. They accompanied the Shanxi merchants on their long journeys. By the end of the 1700s, Da Sheng Kui's businessnot only involved supplying the army's border forces, but also the government's tax collectors in border areas. There were many shops like Da Sheng Kui in Shanxi. These rich and resourceful Shanxi merchantshad become an important force in the economy of its day. Li's pigment shop was one of them. Its abundant capital and mature branch network laid a foundation for the operation of Ershangchang. When Ershangchang was first built, remote remittance was only carried out between Beijing and Shanxi. During this period, Lei accumulated enough capital and also proved to his boss Li the strong vitality of the new business. After that, branches of Ershangchang spread across China. The bank's reputation and credibility were also established.This is the former residence of Lei Lu Tai. It was built in the 1830s, in the heyday of Ershangchang. It seemed that its success brought Lei great wealth. Through the joint efforts of Li and Lei, Ersheng-Chang grew larger and larger, with branches all over China. With these huge profits, Li became the richest man in Pingyao. However, disaster struck. As a familiar and accessible financial institution, the bank came under the scrutiny of the government. In 1840, dozens of ironclads came to the coastlines of China, declaring war against the Qing dynasty. The army, supported by British opium dealers, fought their way all the way to Nanjing. The Qing government was compelled to sign the Treaty of Nanjing with them. According to the treaty, the Qing government would have to give up Hong Kong and open trading ports. Apart from this, it was to pay 21 million silver dollars to Britain as compensation over a four-year period. When the emperor learned that a Shanxi shop called Ersheng-Chang had solved the government's urgent need by exchanging drafts into silver in such a short time, he was very satisfied and personally wrote the four characters meaning land of exchange. This is the board given by Emperor Dao Guang. Today, it is still hidden away in the former site of Ersheng-Chang's head office in Pingyao. The reputation of Ersheng-Chang soon spread all over China, and Shanxi became the financial center of China. From this ordinary shop, the managers of a private bank set their footprints in all parts of the country. In the years that followed, they underwent tremendous changes involving the precarious empire and Eastern civilization. As the first Chinese private bank succeeded, more and more similar banks mushroomed. But at the time, social unrest, bank runs came one after another. How could private banks survive in troubled times? Join us for the next part, Early Days.